Hey guys, welcome back to my channel and welcome to another video. So if you are new here, then hello, my name is Ian. I already graduated medical school, so I think it was the right time to actually share with you guys some of the things that I did in order for me to memorize a lot of things in medical school. So we know that in medical school, there are so many things to memorize. That is not a secret at all. So I have my iPad with me so that I can actually give you guys examples of things that I used in medical school and things that were taught to me for me to be able to memorize it. And since I'm also studying right now, it has been of a big help right now using the following memorizing tools that we can do in order to memorize properly and efficiently in medical school. So I hope that the examples that I will give you will give you a more in-depth understanding of what it is like to actually use a memorizing tool, and I hope that it can help all of us. So okay, so the first one that we're going to talk about are mnemonics. So I'm sure all of you know what mnemonics are. It's basically like phrases or words that can help us in memorizing a certain subject or certain topic. So when there are so many things to memorize, mnemonics can play a part for us to shorten what we need to memorize. So let's first talk about mnemonics and phrases. So the first example that I will show you are for those of the cranial nerve. I know it sounds like a green phrase because, you know, we're talking about, yeah, but you know, regardless of it being green, sometimes we know what they say. The more bastos, the more we remember something. So I guess it kind of helped because until now I still memorize it. The underlined letters are actually the first letter of your cranial nerves, also numbered from cranial 1 to 12. So that includes your olfactory nerve, optic, oculomotor, trochlear, trigeminal, abducens, facial, vestibulocochlear, glossopharyngeal, vagus, accessory, hypoglossal. That is all. Another example is stop making new thrombi. This is a cause of your DIC or disseminated intravascular coagulation. The ones that I have underlined, first letter of the word of the causes of your DIC. Another one is so long to pinky, here comes the tongue, wherein it actually is a mnemonic for the bones of your hand. So as you can see, it's better if you actually draw it for you to remember it. So long to pinky are the ones that are in the bottom, and you go up with your here comes the tongue. So it's like a curve. And the last two were actually mnemonics that I've learned from studying the USMLE step one. And I know when it comes to mnemonic phrases, it's kind of harder for us to memorize sometimes because sometimes it doesn't make sense. Even if it does make sense, sometimes we tend to forget it easier. That's why they're also mnemonic with words. So mnemonics with words are mnemonics that actually is easier to memorize. So let's say, for example, you have your rheumatic fever, your major criteria, you just memorize the word joke and that is it. So you have your joint involvement, carditis, nodules, erythema marginatum, and your Sydenham chorea. It's easier for me to memorize mnemonics when it comes to just, you know, one word, comparing it to memorizing a mnemonic in phrases. If we go back to what we just memorized, the first one, when it comes to phrase, so long to pinky, here comes the thumb. Maybe we will be able to memorize it at the moment that we are studying, but sometimes when we're already taking the test, we kind of, you know, forget it. Sometimes we do remember the parts of the bone, but the fact is sometimes we forget the mnemonic phrase itself. The word mnemonics are actually more helpful for me. So if you can create, you know, word mnemonics, that would be better. So another one is your aspirin side effects. So you have your aplastic anemia, salt and water retention, peptic ulcer, rash, induced bronchial asthma, and nephrotoxicity. So these are your side effects when it comes to aspirin. So it's easier to remember because it comprises the word aspirin. When you hear the word aspirin, what are the side effects of aspirin? You just remember the word itself, aspirin. Okay, the next one is the rule of opposites. So what I want you guys to remember when it comes to opposites is that you should memorize one by heart. So here I've highlighted the things that I would usually remember when it comes to memorizing opposites. Don't memorize it all together because sometimes you'll get confused when it comes with the exam. Sometimes when you're memorizing on the spot, you actually get to memorize it. But when you're answering the exam, they twist the question a little bit, you actually get confused. So memorize one by heart. I suggest that you memorize the one that is more dominant. So let's say, for example, jejunum versus ileum. The ones that I have highlighted are what I consider the more dominant one. So with your jejunum, you have thicker and more vascular walls. You have a wider lumen. You have a longer circular fold or plicae circularis. In comparison to your ileum, it's more fat with your Peyer's patches. Another one that is usually popular in exams when it comes to anatomy is the difference between your right lung and your left lung. So again, as I mentioned, memorize the dominant one instead of the least dominant one, and memorize one by heart. Sometimes kasi if you memorize both together, you will get confused when it comes with the exam. What is the difference between the right lung and the left lung? And they give me the choices. I just remember what are the characteristics of your right lung, and so I can eliminate the ones that are, you know, part of the left lung. So in comparison to the first one that we mentioned situation. When it comes to something like the Crohn's disease and your ulcerative colitis, both have a lot of similarities. So you memorize their differences instead. So for your Crohn's disease, you memorize that there is a stricture, they have skip lesions, and there is no gross blood. Compared to your ulcerative colitis, wherein there is tenesmus, the rectum is always involved, and there are grossly bloody stools. So if you know these differences, you'd be able to identify which one is which. You'll find a lot of similarities between the two since they are both inflammatory bowel diseases. Okay, another one example is this one, marasmus and kwashiorkor. These are also diseases. Which one involves inadequate protein intake and which one involves inadequate caloric intake? So that was like a common question in exams back in medical school. In order for me to remember it, I associated kwa, the letter K, with caloric. So kwashiorkor, caloric, K and C. So, you know, they sound the same. So another thing is when it comes to muscle wasting. This is a clinical feature of marasmus. What I remember in medical school is that I associate M. So if you invert letter M, if you invert letter M, you would actually have A, W. So I would never forget it that marasmus is associated with prominent muscle wasting. Let's move on to word association. Association when it comes to photographs. So let's say when you're given diseases like rubeola, rubella, and roshola infantum. So these are viral illnesses when it comes to your pediatrics. So they may present similar symptoms. In order for you to memorize it fully, you can actually look at pictures like the ones that I presented here. Another thing when it comes to association with photographs and videos is the use of Sketchy Micro. I don't know if you guys have heard of it, but Sketchy Micro has really helped me when it comes to memorizing microbiology. Every bacteria has its own specific story. Staph aureus is a gram-positive bacteria. That's why it's purple. He's having a staph because we're talking about Staph aureus. There's a cat because it's catalase positive. It's actually helpful if you need like photographic memory. And if you want to learn something, you know, just quick and fun, you can actually check out Cells at Work. Next, when it comes to association, is word association. Local anesthetic, so you know it's an amide if there are two eyes. So this example is lidocaine. So lidocaine has two eyes in comparison to your ester, which in there is only one eye. So an example is procaine. These are actually different diseases that are involving your sphingolipidosis diseases. I actually just made this on my own, which really helped me in my biochem exam when it came to this topic. The first one is Fabry disease. So the defective protein is alpha-galactosidase A. So if you guys notice, I've underlined the letter A. Fabry. Alpha galactosidase A, mostly associated with the letter A. Another one is your Gaucher disease. So the defective protein is beta glucosidase U. We're dealing now here with U in comparison to your Fabry. We're dealing at Gaucher. So Gaucher, GAU, is the defective protein is beta glucosidase. Sometimes it sounds lame, but it's actually helped me. And I don't know, maybe this can also help you. And up until now, it has really helped me when asked in exams. Which is the defective protein of Fabry disease? I can easily spot. Ah, it's alpha galactosidase A. Okay, another one when it comes to association is you associate it with an object and person. So these one are two examples. So when it comes to mucopolysaccharidosis, you have your Hunter and your Hurler syndrome. So these two syndromes actually have a lot of similarities. The one big main difference is that they have. One has corneal clouding, the other one has no corneal clouding. Hunter syndrome has no corneal clouding because in order for you to hunt properly, you have clear vision. And for Hurler syndrome, it has with corneal clouding. Another one is that the different causes of your postpartum fever. This one on the left side is actually your postpartum day. And these one are the causes on the right side. It's easy to remember the numbers because it's just divisible by one. And I actually have a story for that. I made this when I was in med school and I can never forget it. It is the story of the fish in the womb. So the first one is wind. So you have your sea breeze here. That's the green one. And then you have your water below the sea breeze because I mean, you're in the sea. There's a fish. It's the story of the fish in the womb because we have a fish now. Inside the fish is a baby. So that's the womb. In order for the baby to come out of the womb, it has to have a wound. Theoretically, a fish doesn't have a womb, but you know, for the purpose of examination and memorization, it can actually help. And when the baby comes out, the baby can walk on its own. Or in that sense, can swim on its own. Yeah, lastly, mastitis because nagbe-breastfeed na. Yeah, that's the way I remember it when it comes to, you know, postpartum day when they ask questions. Which is a common cause of postpartum fever during the first 24 hours. So, wind. So, that is associated with your atelectasis. Okay, let's move on. Another one is the use of flashcards. So, these are some of the apps that I can actually recommend strategy, you can use Quizlet, Anki, and flashcards. And with the use of flashcards, it actually aids in spaced repetition. Speaking of, today's video is actually sponsored by Skillshare. And if you don't know yet, Skillshare is actually an online community that I have been part of for months now. In this online community, you get to learn a lot from different professionals because they create videos for you to learn and know more about their certain area of field. And it's actually great for you to join the community with just less than $10 a month. And I've actually had a hard time with flashcards before, but I've learned a lot from taking classes from Ali Abdal, because Ali Abdal talks more about how it is to use Anki flashcards. So I've been able to use that and slowly learning at the moment, and it's because of Skillshare. If you want to join the community, you can click the link in the description box down below. The first 1,000 will get 2 months free, and I'm sure you're gonna have so much fun when it comes to learning from Skillshare. You can use flashcards that you created on your own. I actually do have flashcards that I bought from Muji. They are small ones, and that I have created notes on the flashcards itself. And another one is by creating groupings or tables. So these are the examples that I can show to you guys when it comes to groupings or tables. So many to memorize when it comes to antibiotics, cephalosporins pa in general. This was actually taught to me. For the first generation, one thing similar about this is that they have pH. I mean, you get the point. When it comes to cephalosporins, it's so much. And I really don't want to memorize mnemonics when it comes to cephalosporins because it can get messy in my head. Instead, this has worked for me better. The other three, I know it doesn't have a pH, but again, at least, onti na lang naiwan for you to memorize. For the second generation, after F, a vowel. If ever there are other second generation drug that doesn't come after na vowel, onti na lang yun. So those are the ones that you need to memorize na lang. When it comes to your third generation, a consonant naman after the letter F compared to your second generation. And if you notice, sinircle ko, it's cefixime, cefoperazone, and cefotaxime associated with money. Fix, pera, and tax. And at least onti na lang i-memorize mo. So thank you so much, Dr. Toff, who actually taught this to us. It's been a really great help. Another one that was taught to me in medical school was the word keeps. So until now, it really stuck to me when I was answering, you know, microbiology exams. So K-E-E-P-S-S. So it's easy to remember, keeps, you know. So you can actually divide it with a line in the middle, K-E-E-P-S-S. K-E-E, Klebsiella, E. coli, Enterobacter are your lactose fermenters. P-S-S is your Proteus, Salmonella, and Shigella are your non-lactose fermenters. So the ones that are also on the last part, your Klebsiella and your Shigella are non-motile. So it's easier for it to remember, keeps, and they ask you questions, which of the following is a non-lactose fermenter? You can actually already eliminate. Also, lastly, also do practice questions. So you do ratio of your old exams. Don't just memorize the answer. When you read a question, minsan we have the tendency to memorize the answer. Also look into all the other choices. Why it wasn't picked as a choice. And maybe you can also learn a thing or two about the other choices even though it wasn't the answer. The more you practice with a lot of questions, you actually get to learn and get to keep it in your memory. And you get to understand how it's asking exams and questions, because sometimes when we're actually studying, when we're memorizing, we think that, oh, we get it. But sometimes when it's asked in an exam, tapos iniikot-ikot na nila yung mga questions, sometimes we tend to get confused. So those are my tips on how to memorize efficiently and effectively in medical school. So I hope this video is going to help you with a thing or two. It just doesn't apply to students in medical school, although the examples that I showed are for medical students. If you have your own mnemonics, your ways of memorization, please do leave it in the comment section below so we can all learn from each other. And until then, don't forget to like this video, subscribe to my channel, and I will see you in my next video. Bye guys!